There are some things in the portal of eternity that God has dropped down to the earth to give man the authority to make a difference in not just a part of his life, not just a component or a portion of his life, that the whole man can be built up and delivered and walking in what God has for him. Anybody here believe in a total transformation?
Yeah.
Anybody here know that Jesus doesn't just save a part of you, but he wants to save all of you? Tell your neighbor one more time, you got the keys, just use them. Y'all gonna have to help me this morning. I remember growing up, Petty, you remember 194, Reed Avenue, apartment 4D. Never got a key until I was about 14, 15 years old. I said, Mom, everybody got a key. All the kids got, my name is Key. When you gonna give me? Okay, she said, boy, you're not gonna lose my key. Right. You ain't ready. As you say, for prime time.
Okay.
And then one day, I must have got on her nerves after months and months and months of just being a nuisance. She said, boy, you worse. So we was at the hardware store, Apostle Ann. At the hardware store, I'm looking on the counter, and the man, he has all these gadgets and gadgets, and he just making, Pastor E, he's just making some new keys. And I said, Mom, come on, come on, Mom, come on. And I saw that he had different ones. They were different. Y'all see, they got different colors. And at the time, my favorite color was blue. Now, but at the time, as a kid, my favorite color was red. Now, huh? I saw that red key, and I just knew all of a sudden it had my name on it. And I was just in love that day. And Mama allowed me to get my first key. You could not convince me, Ed Plum, that I didn't have the key to Fort Knox. All it was the key to 194 Reed Avenue, apartment D4. But to me, that key was the world, because that key became my pride and joy. I put a rope around my neck, tied that key inside that rope, took showers with that key. I was happy.
That's right. Come on.
I got the key. God had begun to show me. Because now, in an early age, the keys, Regina, they represent something. They represent responsibility, first of all. Mama told me that. But then keys also represent access. Somebody say access.
Access.
Keys represent entry. Somebody say entry.
Entry.
Keys represent authority. Somebody say authority.
Authority.
And keys represent permission. Somebody say permission.
Permission.
See, when you have keys, you have all of that in just that key. I don't care if it's a digital key. Have you ever been in a situation like I was this morning? You trying to get into your own account? Come on here, somebody. And you can't remember whatever your password, and you looking like a fool, and you know, line getting long, and you're like, man, I know this is. Because keys represent permission. Watch this. When someone says someone broke in my house, one of the first things they're going to tell you, police officer, what are they going to tell you? Does anybody else have a key? Because keys represent official permission. If somebody got your keys, it's like you gave them permission.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor,
you got the keys.
Just use them. So question. I got a question for you. What keys then must we realize and recognize and then obtain so we can go get our stuff back? What are the keys that God wants us to operate right here, right now, so that we can go get back the stuff that the enemy has stolen from us? Is there a witness in the house? In a lot of cases, watch this, this is how the enemy has done. He has come in and he has literally, for some of us, he has robbed us. Blood. Has anybody ever been burglarized? It is the most demoralizing experience. Anybody here, I mean, broke the engine, broke in your car, broke in your house? It messes with your mind. Watch this. Not just because your stuff is gone, but because somebody had the audacity, watch this, to invade your privacy, come into your personal space, and act like it was their own. They ain't worked nowhere, put no time in, and gonna make themselves comfortable in your space. Watch this, you gotta get this. In a lot of cases, the enemy, watch this, he took our stuff, Nikki, in broad daylight, I'll say that again. You gotta catch this.
Come on.
Usually, most burglaries, they say, you know, the nighttime because they want to get away without being detected. But our enemy, this is how clever he is and how bold he is, he'll come in ruthless as he is in broad daylight. Say, neighbor, how does he do that? Good question. I'm glad you asked. Watch this. Because while we live in darkness, he has the ability to do so. When we are in darkness, he can walk in broad daylight. Watch this. He don't have to kick no door in. He don't have to bust out no back window. He just takes the key and walk right in the front door. Come on, somebody give God praise, because we're with the enemy this morning. And I don't know about you, but I want to get everything back. I lost some stuff. Anybody here lost some stuff? Times in your life, periods, I can count. Amen. Months just depressed and broke down and just joy. Felt like it was gone. Lost purpose, lost meaning. Amen. Have you ever lost peace?
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's yours. You ain't got to give it up. Watch this. And we can get the stuff back when we got the keys. So I want to give you three real quick. And I'm going to share with you very, very quickly three master keys, if you will, that will help us to get all of our stuff back. First, I want to take you to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6. And in Matthew chapter 6, I want to just read just a few verses. Starting in verse 5. And when you pray, Jesus says, you shall not be like who? The hypocrites. Amen. For they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the street, that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But you, when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in secret place. Amen. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. What does he say?
Open.
And when you pray, do not use as many repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. He says, therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask. Let's give them this. Watch this. Even if there was ever a master key, here's what I came to tell you this morning, truth for life. If there was ever a master key that we need to develop and cultivate and grow in for mastery purpose, it is the key of prayer.
Amen.
Good God Almighty, the name of Jesus. I said it is the key to prayer. We are literally living in a prayerless society. And those of us who do pray, we pray so officially. Come on here now. We pray so much old King James that folk don't even know what we're talking about. Come on. Like your prayer is holier. Yeah. But the word teaches us we have not, because we ask God. The word teaches us that if we bind it on earth, it'll be bound in heaven. If we loose it on earth, it'll be loosed in heaven when we pray. That was a key that we need to use today. It would be the master key of prayer. Why? Because prayer is nothing but authentic communication between earth and heaven. And there must always be dialogue between earth and heaven. That's how his will is done on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. It happens when we pray.
Amen.
Do you know what happens when we don't pray? Ask your neighbors and neighbor. I wonder what happens when we don't pray. Now look at them and say nothing.
Nothing.
Absolutely. So we need to pray. Watch this. Because prayer is heart to heart, spirit to spirit relationship with God.
Amen.
Prayer, watch this, it's like the umbilical cord between a mother and the child. Everything the parent wants to give to that child it needs to comes through that cord. Prayer is that divine connection that allows us, watch this, it's not just words, because some of us, have you ever prayed, come on, I need some praise in the house. Have you ever prayed and ran out of words? And you felt kind of weird, kind of awkward. That's a good thing. Watch this. That's the best prayer.
That's right.
Because prayer really is not in the words. Watch this. Prayer is in the spirit. Prayer is like worship.
That's good.
They that worship God. Come on, somebody. Must worship him.
Amen.
we say.
Come on.
Whether it's in the pulpit or the parking lot, God is in the spirit. Watch this. And when Jesus taught his disciples to pray, watch this. He taught them in such a way, Brad. He said, first, before I teach you how to pray, I'm going to teach you how not to pray.
That's right.
He said, Apostle, he said, don't do it like the hypocrites. Lesson number one, don't do it like that. So prayer then is a very important key because prayer must be authentic. Y'all know I like them spy movies. You know what I'm saying? I like those adventure movies. I like that 007 type stuff. You know what I'm saying? And you ever see when they're going in and they're going into underground into some laboratory where nobody else even knew that the laboratory is. Come on, y'all. And they don't have the stuff where you put your hand. No, they put your eye in it. Man, I mean, they just read your whole digital makeup like that. Mm-hmm. Prayer's kind of like that.